this morning, you get to be blessed by a wonderful young man to sing the special. I'm quite fond of him. I think my wife's quite fond of him, too. I'll sing the special this morning before Brother Absher brings some music.
Still amazes me. That's one of my favorite songs that Wayne does. I love the message in that song. Amen. God's grace never ceases to amaze me. And that's why I like that hymn, Amazing Grace. Amen. What a wonderful, wonderful, loving Heavenly Father and Savior, Holy Spirit, we enjoy as the family of God. I want you to turn with me to Matthew 7, the concluding portion of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. I want us to look together from verse 24 through verse 29. Matthew 7, 24 through 29. After Jesus has shared all of his precepts and teachings and truths on the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, this is his concluding statement. Notice what he says. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon the house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. And it came to pass when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Well, certainly Jesus did have authority. He could talk about heaven, and what he said was true because he had been there. He could talk about this earth, and what he said was true because he created it. He could talk about humankind, and what he said was true because he created us, and he also observed our fallen nature and knew exactly what had to be done for that nature to be redeemed. Here he tells us, if we listen and heed and obey his teachings, what we're building in life will prevail. But he said, if we hear the teachings of God and do not obey his teachings, then our life will fall and end in utter ruin at the end of our days. I want us to consider this morning upon what foundation we're building. What foundation are you and I building upon? I was looking in some of my research work that I use sometimes to illustrate what I'm going to say, and it said this. Did you know that the Empire State Building stands 103 stories tall? Now think of that. 103 stories tall. It reaches 1,253 feet into the air, about a quarter of a mile in height. If all the materials which went into the construction of this building had been loaded onto one train, it would have been 57 miles long. The building contains 10 million bricks. My dad and grandpa would have loved that. They were brick masons. Had over 6,000 windows, 75 miles of water pipe. Had 2 million feet of electrical wiring. We've got some electricians here. 2 million feet of electrical wire. Gigantic building in its day. This gigantic structure weighing in excess of 303,000 tons. Now imagine that. 303,000 tons needed a tremendous foundation. The architects and engineers excavated down until they reached solid granite, which is the basic rock of our earth. And it was upon this rock that they laid the foundation for the Empire State Building. Jesus concludes his sermon on the Mount by saying that just as a building must have a firm foundation, so must our lives be built upon a solid foundation if we're going to be able to weather the storms of life and the test of eternity. Are you prepared for the storms of life? Have you built on a secure foundation that when the storms of life come, and by the way, they will, are you prepared? Is your soul anchored upon the eternal rock, Christ Jesus? Are you ready for the test of eternity? When the Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment, are you prepared to give answer to your personal experience with God and the life that you've lived, the things you've done, the words you've spoken, the lifestyle you've lived? Is your life on a solid foundation? In this passage of Scripture, Jesus gave to us instructions and specifications for building a true Christian life, one that will stand the test of time and one that will pass the test of judgment. First of all, Jesus spoke of two foundations upon which we can build our lives. And by the way, there are only two. One of these foundations is faulty. Look at verse 26. Everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. He said to hear or even know the teachings of Christ and then not to heed them or obey them, you're building your life on a faulty foundation. It will not stand the test of life nor the test of eternity. Many people today are selecting faulty foundations for the construction of their life. There are some who are building their lives upon a materialistic foundation which will never sustain them, especially in death and the judgment of God. Look back to chapter 6 and let's read together verse 19 and 20 and 21. Jesus said, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth where moth and rust doth corrupt and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. He says, where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. Are you building on a sure foundation? Are you building on the sands of life? One way that you and I can know if we're being duped by materialism is for us to ask ourselves, do we even consider God with our material blessing? Do we acknowledge that He is the one that gave us the strength and the energy and the mentality to earn the things that we've earned and to have the things that we have? Do we acknowledge God? Is our heart bent upon tithing to Him and giving to Him and using our resource to help others along the way? There are other people today who are building their lives around pleasure. And my friends, we're living in an age of hedonism. It's a hedonistic society. In fact, it's an age where it amazes me how much we'll spend for pleasure. There's nothing wrong with traveling. There's nothing wrong with having a good time. But when our resources are tied up in a lust after pleasure, when I think about what ball players make, it amazes me compared to school teachers, for instance. Millions of dollars a year. The winner of the British Open won $1.4 million for 4 days of golf. Now think of that. And basketball players make millions. Baseball players, millions. Not to mention what it took to build the stadiums that we throng into and give money to in order to watch our favorite sports activity. But Jesus said in Matthew 6:33, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all necessary things will be added unto you." Can you imagine if God's people gave to the church what they give for pleasure? What they give for the things of this world? Can you imagine the resources that missionaries and churches would have? There are also those who are building their lives upon a foundation of common sense. They're putting their faith in education and science and human achievement. They're building on the foundation of evolution, a godless beginning. They're building their lives on a foundation of humanism. Whatever my family needs, I'll provide it. And I don't need anyone else telling me what to do with my resources. My friend, if you're of that faith and belief, you're going to find that your life is built upon the sand. And it will not stand the test of life. Neither will it stand the test of judgment. I'm so thankful that Jesus points out that there's another foundation on which we can build our lives. And please understand that this foundation is sure. It's sure. Brother Absher feels such a sense of peace today. I feel such a sense of security and well-being. Why? Because I know, should this day be the last day on this earth, it is well with my soul. That my life is built upon the teachings of Jesus Christ and upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And I know that His words are true and that to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. That's something to be thankful for. Something to rejoice in. By a sure foundation, Jesus is referring to faith in Himself as the Savior. Look ahead to Matthew 16. Such a powerful passage of Scripture. Matthew chapter 16. And notice as we pick up at verse 13 what Jesus said. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, He asked His disciples, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" They said, some say you're John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And then Jesus said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered, thou art the Christ, the Messiah, the promised Son of God, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter. The Greek word means small stone. And upon this rock, and the Greek word means bedrock foundation. The strongest foundation you could ever build upon. I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. What was the bedrock foundation? It was the confession that Jesus is the Messiah. The fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy. That Jesus indeed is and was the Son of the living God. And that when he died, his death made a difference. He was pure, never sinned. We are impure and have sinned. But when he died on the cross, God accepted his perfect life of righteousness for our life of imperfection. And if we'll simply acknowledge we're sinners and believe on the Lord and live according to his teachings, bless your heart, we're on a solid foundation. We're on a faulty foundation if we know that we haven't trusted Jesus as our Savior and his Word as our source of truth. By a sure foundation, Jesus is certainly referring to obedience to him. Look back to Matthew 7, verse 24 again. He says, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. My friends, without obedience, we're not building on a sure foundation. That's why James says, faith without works is dead, being alone. Oh, yes, we're saved by grace, but in the same Ephesians 2, 8, 9, and 10, in verse 10, it says, we're created in Christ Jesus unto good works. To as many as receive Christ, to them he gives the power to be the sons and daughters of God. Matthew 5, verse 17. Think not that I'm come to destroy the law or the commandments. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle, not even a dot over an I or a comma, shall pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you that except your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter the kingdom of heaven. My friends, to be on a sure foundation. Brother Abshire loves you, and I'm speaking the truth to you. We must obey the Word of God. Are we building on a sure foundation? The answer to this question is very important, because I found in my years of life that the storms of life are certain to come. There's some of you who could stand to give testimony that the storms of life have come to you. In the conclusion of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus speaks of rains descending and winds blowing and the waves beating against the house of our life. Please notice that Jesus pointed out the storms come to both houses, the house on the sand, as well as the house on the rock, the faulty foundation and the sure foundation. Will experience the storms of life. There's no immunity or escape from the realities of life. Doesn't mean you're not a Christian to be going through a storm. Storms come to both houses. The difference is we're on a sure foundation. We've got a faith to see us through. We've got grace sufficient to attend to our needs. You may experience sickness. Some of you have, and some of you are. But if you're on a solid foundation, bless your heart, you're the winner. Nothing can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. We will experience the storm of death. Death will knock at the door of every household. But thank God. I could say to Jim McDowell's family and Ruth Milstead's family and to Mike Wheeler's family, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. As we learned last Sunday and Sunday night, we will experience the storm of temptation and evil influence. But with every temptation, if you're on the solid foundation, He'll make a way of escape. No, life will not always be easy for the child of God, but it will be blessed. It will be blessed. And what a joy to serve the Lord throughout life. Now, because of the choice of foundations and the certainty of the storms of life, there are two possible endings for your life and for mine. The life of faith and obedience will be stable and secure. Whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I'll liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. The rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew and beat upon the house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. The life which is not founded upon Jesus Christ will fall. Verse 26 and 7 says, everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. The rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it. What a tragedy for a person to have every opportunity, because whosoever will may come. And to take carelessly the teachings of Jesus Christ in this life that is but a vapor and only appears for a little while, and we come to the judgment seat of Christ unprepared to meet God. Nothing will remain for us in that state. Turn with me quickly, if you will, to 2 Peter. And I want to read just a short portion with you. 2 Peter chapter 3. And let's look at verse 10. He says, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. We'll be giving in marriage, drinking and being merry. Life will be going on as usual, just like today. But the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. And notice what Peter says. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought we to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved and the elements shall melt with fervent heat? Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that you look for such things, be diligent that you may be found of Christ. Notice, in peace, right relationship with each other, as well as God, without spot, blameless. No wonder it's imperative for us, as Jesus spoke in the conclusion of his Sermon on the Mount, that we consider what foundation we're building upon. So much is dependent on whether or not we have heard the teachings of Christ and that we have responded in faith to them and are living in obedience each day. So much depends upon the foundation we're building upon, not only in this life, but certainly in the life to come. Shall we stand together as Brother Wayne comes to lead us in a time of invitation? If you want to pray and talk to God today about anything the Lord's revealed to you, the altar on my left is for you to come and pray privately, or the front pew. If you want me to meet with you, you come over to my right or the front pew, and I'll be glad to share with you from the Word of God. Be sure you're building on a sure foundation. Let us sing together, page 160, Only Trust Him.
Sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and He will surely give you rest by trusting in His word. Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him now. He will save you, He will save you, He will save you now. For Jesus shed His precious blood, rich blessings to bestow. Plunge now into the crimson flood that washes white as snow. Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him now. He will save you, He will save you.
You know what amazes me at the camp meetings and revivals that I preach? I can remember in my early ministry, it was a mixture between adults and young people. But in these last years, I told Sister Abtree, it just amazes me at how few adults respond to the message of God. It amazes me. In this last camp meeting, every service, morning and night, the altars were filled with young people weeping, seeking God. 25 of them gave their lives to Jesus Christ. Isn't that wonderful? We had a few adults, had one backslidden preacher come back to the Lord, and two or three others during the whole week. And I told the church, "Church, listen, God is not through with any of us yet. He's still working on your pastor. I certainly haven't arrived in my spiritual pilgrimage." So don't ever feel bad to respond to an altar of prayer. We're not counting numbers. But I'll tell you one thing. I want my soul to be on a sure foundation, don't you? I want to be ready when Jesus calls. Paul said, "What a terrible thing. After teaching others, I myself should be a castaway." What a terrible thing to go to church for years and never measure up to what God's asking us to do. Let's sing this last verse in closing. If God's speaking, you come. Obey Him today.
Come then and join this holy band and unto glory go to dwell in that celestial land where joys immortal flow.
Here's the key.
Only trust Him.
So much for your presence here. I love each and every one of you. If you need Sister Abshaw or myself at any time, you call upon us because we want to be able to minister to you. Come back to